You and Roger then went on to write Scenes from a Mall?
Roger and I, yes. What are we going to do next? Is that the next picture?
Yeah.
Next, I said, let's do our version of Scenes from a Marriage, but let it all take place in the mall. Everything's in the mall except maybe a little thing at the beginning.
Mm-hmm.
And I was going to get Meryl Streep and Kevin Kline. It was in my head.
Right.
And the studio bought it. They loved the script.
Uh-huh.
They were a little nervous, only two people, except there's a clown.
Mm-hmm.
There's a mime. There's me as a... They didn't know it was going to be me. I played Hans somebody. You mm-hmm. see him on television, a psychiatrist. All in all, I'm getting ready to go for Meryl and through Sam Cohen. I think she would have done it.
Mm-hmm.
And Kevin Kline, who's a wonderful actor.
Mm-hmm.
I get a call from Eisner, Paul, Michael. What would you say to using Woody Allen?
Hmm.
Well, he doesn't do other people's movies. He said, he needs a payday. And I think he would do this movie. Have you spoken to Sam? I said, yeah. He said, Sam mentioned bada boom, bada boom. He can get him a script. I said, I don't know. He's brilliant, but he's not a great actor, really. He's not. He's Woody Allen.
Right.
He'll be accepted as Woody Allen.
Mm-hmm.
He said, well, what if you use Bette Miller as his wife? You know her, you've worked with her. I said, Woody and Bette, wow, Jesus. I don't know. Let me think about it. Now I'm torturing myself.
Mm-hmm.
Am I whoring? Am I? If I do it with Meryl and the other one, it could be very moving,
right?
And funny. They both know humor.
Mm-hmm.
She can be very funny, and he can be hilarious. And it could be a real story of a marriage
mm-hmm.
where both people have cheated,
mm-hmm.
and all of that, et cetera, et cetera. Woody Allen, Bette Midler, Woody Allen, Bette Midler. I'm going crazy. I'm asking everybody I know.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going up to parking guys. What do you think of a movie with Woody Allen and Bette Midler? I love it. Can't wait to see it. You know, valet parkers.
Mm-hmm.
I call Sam, my agent in New York. He says, let me get it to Woody. You'll get an answer tomorrow. He'll read it right away. Mm-hmm. Needs a payday. How much of a payday can he get? I don't know. He said, Paul, he can get a big payday. They're desperate for him.
Mm-hmm.
I get a call the next day. Sam says, Woody's in.
Mm-hmm.
But he has three things he wants to talk to you about. All right, let me talk to him. So I get on the phone with him. Paul, Woody, very good. I love the script. I'll do it with Bette Midler. But there's three things. You've got a scene where he says so-and-so. Can I change it to so-and-so? I mm-hmm. said, Woody, you can change any line you want.
Mm-hmm.
What's the second thing? He said, I can't cry.
Hmm.
I don't cry. I said, can you look sad? Yeah, I can look sad. That's easy for me. You don't have to cry. You do whatever you would do in that situation, be okay mm-hmm. with me. But you could look really sad. Yeah, I said, would you wear a ponytail? No, there's no way I'll wear a ponytail. Come on, Woody, please. No, well, if you really want it, maybe, I don't know. What's the third thing? You got to shoot it in New York.
Hmm.
I said, it takes place in a mall in L.A. You got to do it in New York. I don't. So, boom, boom, boom. I start going through with Pato and this and that.
Mm-hmm.
I know there's a mall in Connecticut, the interior of which maybe could work. I see the mall out here. I'm looking at it. Mm-hmm. I figure out the only way I can do it, I've got to get him out here for a tiny bit to show it's California, and him riding in the car with her up to the Beverly Center.
Right.
And parking, and a little bit, 3 days' work.
Mm-hmm.
He finally agrees to do it if they'll fly him and Mia and 83 kids to here, and they put him up at the greatest hotel, and they bring two nannies, something mm-hmm. like that. They agree. Private jet, that right away added $500,000 to the budget. I didn't care.
Mm-hmm.
And he and Bette each got about I don't want to mention the number. Right. It's a lot.
Yeah.
And shooting in New York meant I'm going to do the exteriors of the mall there and the interior of the mall in Connecticut, which has the elevator, the thing, which I did. And then I had to build the floor in which most of it takes place at a studio in New York where Pato created an incredible thing.
Right.
That with the name of a bread, silver.
That silver cup.
Silver cup. So we did it, and I would say because of Woody and all of that, more power to him.
Mm-hmm.
The budget was a lot higher than it would have been.
Mm-hmm.
So I get a call while we're in New York, Pato and I, trying to make this thing for a little bit less. We can't do it. It's going to be 18.5.
Right.
They send out their top guy.
Mm-hmm.
I said, what are you talking about? You can do it with a boom, but a bomb, but a boom. I said, well, you go, come with me and I'll show you this. I'll show you the shots. You'll look through a lens. I'll do this with you. I'll take you through the whole movie. That's how good I was. We finish it. He says, I think it should be a little bit more. Okay, fine. That's next. Now it's up to about 20.
Mm-hmm.
I think they had two separate books to show.
Right.
They didn't want the press to know. They were okay, though. They didn't bother me.
Mm-hmm.
And then we make the movie, and I'm rehearsing with me, Woody, and Bette, and my assistant, a script girl.
Right.
In a big place in New York.
Mm-hmm.
You know, a studio.
Rehearsal?
Odd. Mm-hmm. Me, Woody, and Bette. And he's got a big surfboard he has to carry. I didn't think he could make it.
Mm-hmm.
I got him to test the ponytail,
mm-hmm.
which was wonderful. He didn't want to do it, but he did it for me. He did it. He loves me. You know, you saw what he wrote.
Mm-hmm.
You saw that.
Yeah.
I like him. They had lunch. The first lunch, I think she had a diet shake, and he had, I think, a Snicker. Want some? Or a corned beef sandwich. I mean, there's the two different.
Yeah,
and they got along, but I think she was a little in awe. Mm-hmm. And then they calmed down, and we did the beginning of the movie in a studio, the bed scenes and all that, and they were hilarious. Anyway, we finished the movie, and now it's clear when we test the movie that the first third is hilarious. He's getting calls, she's getting calls, falling out of bed. I mean, it was not Kevin Kline and her, but it was them, and I believed her as whatever she was, and I believed him as a sports guy. It's sort of, you know, a guy who sells, I don't know, sneakers and stuff.
Right.
Kind of. Still, I know deep down the audience is waiting for Woody Allen riffs.
Right.
Which they're not going to get.
Mm-hmm.
When the movie hits like the two-thirds mark and it gets sadder, Michael Eisner said at that point, he didn't use these words, he felt a little, his seat got a little uncomfortable.
Mm-hmm.
And he said that's where it slowed down for him. So I go back with the editor, and we're fooling around with it, and I take a little bit out of this, a little bit out, take about 5 minutes out.
Mm-hmm.
And that was the movie.
Right.
It was everything I wanted, but it's touching at the end. I haven't seen it in a long time. I'd have to.
Right.
Vincent Canby gave it a good review. He was not a big fan of mine. He gave Unmarried Woman a good review, too.
So it was a Paul Mazursky film for people who don't like Paul Mazursky films?
Something like that. But he liked the movie. And it was a hit in Paris. They love Woody.
Right.
And they liked the humor of it. They liked it.
Mm-hmm.
I must confess, confused because, you know, it reminded me of the days I did my comedy act, where in some towns I'd do great.
Right.
And in other towns I wouldn't.
Mm-hmm.
I did great in San Francisco. I did great in New York. I did great in Chicago. I bombed in Boston. I bombed in Dallas.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe the same thing happens in movies. I don't know.
Mm.
You know.
Interesting.
Maybe the Midwest wants who knows what. Well, they're hipper now because of the internet and everything. Right. Everybody knows everything now.
Or they all think they do.
Or they think they do.
So The Pickle was a much more personal film, it seems, than...
The Pickle was a personal film, which I wrote, which Frank Price came to my rescue again, and bought it, and I wanted to play the lead. Mm-hmm. I wanted Elliot Gould, they didn't want him. I wanted Donald Sutherland, they didn't want him. Huh. They weren't hot anymore.
Right.
Not enough to carry a movie.
Uh-huh.
They wanted Danny Aiello. I said, what about Danny Aiello? They said yes.
Mm-hmm.
But I offered to do it free.
Mm.
I knew I could play that guy. I knew it.
Mm-hmm.
Frank said, Paul, I know you're a good actor, but it ain't going to work. I can't do it. I can't do it. I need. So we did it. And there's some wonderful things in the movie. It is personal.
Mm-hmm.
I got Shelley Winters again. Fred Murphy shot it. And the flashbacks with the kid and the parents and all that are quite wonderful.
Mm-hmm.
The flying pickle. I think the only place I definitely could have done better is the story I had within a story of what happens in this strange land,
right,
where the pickle takes place.
Mm-hmm.
I think I could have done a better script. I don't know. You never know. I had Little Richard playing the president of a country.
Right.
I had pickle juice falling on Dudley Moore.
Mm-hmm.
I had people wearing weird outfits and I did all kinds of weird stuff.
Mm-hmm.
They had no faith in the movie whatsoever.
Mm-hmm.
It was now whoever it was, Savoy or someplace, I don't know who.
Right.
No, it wasn't Savoy. And they tricked me. They decided not to show the movie to the critics.
Mm-hmm.
To open on Friday, and I found this out,
and
I flipped. I said, how can you do that with my reputation? They said, we want to have a good weekend. I said, you're not going to have a good weekend. You got to advertise it. You got to right. take... Anyway, that's what happened. So The Pickle, I'm teased about The Pickle. I like The Pickle.
Mm-hmm.
I don't like everything in it, but I like it. You never know. And I have people like you do with every movie.
Right.
Boy, I love The Pickle. You know. So that's The Pickle. You've got Faithful. That's a long story, which...
And not your script.
Not my script.
Rare commodity for you.
I made 3 movies, not my script.
Mm-hmm.
Faithful, with Chaz Palminteri, Cher, Ryan O'Neill. Not bad.
Mm-hmm.
Winchell for HBO, Tucci won the Emmy. I would have won it probably had they put my name in. Mm. They forgot.
That's not good.
They did.
Mm-hmm.
They just forgot.
Mm.
And Tucci won.
Mm-hmm.
And deservedly. And then I made Coast to Coast from a Freddie Raphael script.
Mm-hmm.
Great writer. 2 for the Road. And Freddie loved the movie.
Mm-hmm.
And I like it, with Richard Dreyfuss and Judy Davis, Maximilian Schell, and myself, in a pretty good part, and a few others. And that was done for Showtime.
Mm-hmm.
And then I made, and it did okay.
Right.
But it was not released in theaters.
Yeah.
And it's on DVD and all of that. Winchell was very successful.
And that was HBO, yeah?
Yeah, HBO. They were very nice. $10 million to make it. HBO.
Yeah.
And then I made Yippee, which is a documentary that I made in Oman about Hasidic Jews.
Mm-hmm.
So that's the story.
So what got you to Yippee? I mean, the idea of doing your own documentary, self-funded, I guess, I assume.
Yeah.
Just because you love
Yippee
the idea of a story?
Or? $2.6 million.
Huh.
No. Cost about $40,000. Happy to spend it.
But you decided you wanted the story was compelling to you? You wanted to do something?
Well, what happened? Why did I do it? Okay. The guy who makes my eyeglasses is named David Moretzky.
Mm-hmm.
He's a Hasidic Jew. But he doesn't wear the big black hat and doesn't have the huge beard. But he is Hasidic, trimmed beard.
Mm-hmm.
And he's sophisticated. He reads a lot. He reads Philip Roth. Paul, he talks like this. Paul, you have to go to Oman. You have to go to, your heart will change there. I know you are a secular Jew. Go to Oman. Go for Rosh Hashanah, the Jewish New Year. You'll see what happens.
Mm.
It's fantastic. You'll see us singing and dancing 24 hours. This, that, boom, bam. He kept telling me for 2 years, and finally I had nothing to do.
Mm-hmm.
And I saw some pictures of it. I made some phone calls. I got a hold of Bill McGallis, the cameraman.
Mm-hmm.
I got my son-in-law, Steve, to be the second camera. And I went with David as my guide.
Mm-hmm.
And I interviewed two other Hasidic Jews here.
Mm-hmm.
And I went there for a week and made the movie. Great experience, a lot of fun. Difficult physically.
Mm-hmm.
I broke my wrist accidentally a month before in Santa Fe. Anyway, and that's it.
So you've recently had your 80th birthday.
I recently had my 80th birthday.
How does Hollywood feel about 80-year-old directors?
I wouldn't know. I don't live in Hollywood. I live in Beverly Hills. How do they... They feel the way, if I was running a studio, probably I would feel.
Hmm.
Let's get the kids to make these movies. Let's get Judd Apatow.
Mm-hmm.
Let's get Todd Phillips. Let's get Jon Favreau. I don't blame them one bit. I don't make those movies.
Mm-hmm.
I don't. And some of them are funny. And they're making a lot of money. But I do make movies like Unmarried Woman, Down and Out in Beverly Hills,
mm-hmm.
Whatever you call them, you know the names of them. And some of them made a lot of money. Mm-hmm. I probably still can make one that would make money. But it's riskier to them. They perceive it differently, and they may be right. Mm-hmm. I never quarrel with it. I don't argue with it. In fact, I don't even complain about it anymore because it's pointless. And I don't think it's a new thing.
Mm-hmm.
I think they were complaining. Billy Wilder used to complain, who I knew. I didn't know him very well, but I had dinner with him two or three times,
mm-hmm.
at New Year's Eve twice. And he made endless cracks about studios.
Mm-hmm.
And when he hit about 65 or 70, he couldn't get a job anymore. I don't know the exact ages.
Mm-hmm.
And his last couple of movies were not as good as the others.
Mm-hmm.
You know? And maybe we run out of gas, maybe we don't. I know I still have a good movie in me, but I am getting bored or tired of chasing it.
Mm-hmm.
You don't want to go to these meetings where you're like, you know, you've got your hat literally in your hand. You know, so I do a lot of acting. I've acted in Once and Again,
mm-hmm.
Curb Your Enthusiasm. I have a slight cough. Curb, Sopranos.
Mm-hmm.
Those are all people who know me.
Right.
You know, whatever their names were. Edswick,
mm-hmm.
Chase.
Mm-hmm. David Chase.
Larry David, yeah, mm-hmm. David Chase. And it's a lot of fun. I love it. It's like a holiday. Acting is like, now I'm getting good parts.
Mm-hmm.
Relatively good. Another documentary, I would do one if I could think of one.
Mm.
Oman was easy because the shooting only took a week in Russia,
right.
Ukraine, and about 5 days here, on mm-hmm. and off. And it cost about $40,000. I'd be happy to do it again mm-hmm. for that price.
And yeah.
We've made some of it back,
mm-hmm.
and it's played in about 25 festivals. It still plays.
So you're back to acting?
I'm trying to get another movie made. I have two scripts out, which one was written in 1832 that I wrote 200 Pictures of Fiddlemen,
uh-huh.
which I wrote with Roger Simon based on a novel by Bernard Mollenhauer. I haven't able to get the right actor to play the part. Right now, somebody, Raffaella De Laurentiis, wants to make it, but
mm-hmm.
it's a long shot.
And you're maybe going back to theater.
And I'm working on a musical right now of Moon Over Parador,
mm-hmm.
the musical for Broadway. Bill Conti has done the music. I've heard 3 songs now, orchestrated. We've got 5 more, which we're working on.
Mm-hmm.
And in about 2 weeks, I will go with that disc and the book, which Leon and I have written,
mm-hmm.
and bring it to three or four producers who are interested, I know.
Mm-hmm.
But whether it happens or not, it's a long haul. I'm supposed to co-direct it
mm-hmm.
and produce it.
And still working your butt off at 80 years old?
I'm still working. Yeah, I'm not working my butt off because today I had a facial at 10 o'clock to prepare for this. I hope it looks good. And then I had coffee, a little lunch across the street
mm-hmm.
at the Earth Cafe, where Jeff Canoe, an editor friend of mine, a director, and Sebastian Aloy, a Argentinian producer,
mm-hmm.
we sat and looked at 45 girls wearing skirts up to here, where you could see everything, and we just pretended we were still, that I was, whatever. Yeah, I'm having a good time. And I'm going to get the Lifetime Achievement Award from the LA Film Critics, which cost me $13,000. But who minds? Who cares? And I'll say one thing, which is important that I say, because that sums up how I feel about everything. Schwartz meets Cohen in the garment district, and he says, "I heard about the fire. Shh, tomorrow." It's my favorite joke. Yeah.